to, I didn't apply for the position this weekend. But I've been asked to share with you is a perspective, and it's a perspective on reality that is on our world and on our universe. And it's a different perspective, it's another perspective from which we view reality. We've gone through several during our very brief time together since last night, and this one's different. This one, I think that the pieces that make up or comprise the kind of perspective or view that I'm sharing with you includes science, that includes physical sciences, as well as quantum science, quantum physics and astrophysics as well. It includes, it's my attempt to integrate these perspectives that have been pinched on my life. To me, because of my training, there's a lot of science that tells me about the reality of the world. And science is a set of modalities through which we can view the world itself. It also comes from the mystical traditions of both the East and the West. Included certainly our Christian mysticism and Hinduism, but also Sufism and Buddhism as well. It's sourced, I think, in, I have a fairly deep background in theology, and particularly in Franciscan spirituality, because Franciscan spirituality allowed me to integrate what I know of the spirit world and of the scientific world, and those do not have to be separate, but are integrated within that view. And I think my own personal ruminations, thinking, spiritual, contemplative experience, maybe the thread that has sort of pulled these together. But I am gonna try to tell you the universe story in 20 minutes. But that means that I know that you all have read and thought about and imaged many times in yourself. So I'm really reminding you of something that you already know, and perhaps I'm bringing it together in a little bit different perspective. The beginning slide is just a painting that I love. This is Ansgar Holmberg, and the name of her painting and the cover of the book, not written by her, but it was used as the book cover for Beatrice Rimpo's book, which is God's ecstasy. And from this perspective, God's ecstasy, perspective would be the fullness of the divine, the fullness of the fountain which overflows. That fullness of fountain overflowing is an image that comes from 13th century St. Bonaventure, of a person community, of the Godhead as a person community. So I'm going to use a series of really simple diagrams, and the first one is just representative of the whole, or of the allness. I would call this the divine realm. It is also referred to as the causal realm. It's referred to as the causal realm in certainly in Eastern tradition. And it is essentially love. In essence, the ground, this is the ground of the being of all the universe, this is certainly the ground of being of our existence, that this ground is in itself and in its essence, it is simply love, but it is also relationship. So the Christian tradition has seen or named this as Trinity. The Hindu tradition saw this 1,000 years earlier than the Christian tradition and named it the Satchitananda, the being, consciousness, bliss. Somehow, this divine realm gives rise to what we would call the spiritual realm, and what the Eastern traditions call the subtle realm. And it's the realm of potentiality. It's the realm of all of the possibilities of all that could be. Amazingly, Bonaventure in the 13th century had that view. Now, he's Franciscan, and he has to be Christian, because that's all that there is in Europe in the 13th century. So he's pondering this, how do things come into being? And he says, God the Father speaks his word. And he's, in speaking his word, he speaks all that there could ever be. And it is the word that becomes flesh and lives among us. So I'm parsing this apart a little bit more and saying that this subtle realm then, this realm that we call the spiritual, is the realm of the word, that of the potentialities of all it might be. So it also refers to all of the divine qualities. The Sufi liturgy comprises of chanting the 99 holy names of the divine. They ain't making them up. They're receiving them from their own inner consciousness. At the same time, Francis of Assisi in the 13th century heard many of the holy names of God and placed them in a prayer. He isn't making them up. He didn't read them out of a book. He's hearing these holy names of what the source of the ground is. In quantum physics, I would suspect that this is the quantum vacuum, or it is dark matter and dark energy, that which exists. Most of the universe is nothing. Most of what is within your body is nothing. It's vacuum. And so that may be comparable or exactly equal to the spiritual realm. Recently, I've been strongly suspecting that this realm is also the realm of heaven. That as our potentialities, as our potentialities become realities, then they feed back into the potentiality. So I'm going to tell you in a moment that we originate, our origin is within this realm. And we come into the world of the physical world. But what we do in the physical world comes back into the realm of potential and makes something possible in the next now that wouldn't have been possible in the next now had you not done it in today's now. I'm sorry, that just came out. That was not in this book.
It's like you said, I got it. It makes sense. I like it.
Right, you record it. Record it quick. So in this divine and spiritual realm, there ain't no time yet. There's no time, no space, no matter. But at some point, according to our calculation and our perspective, we would call it about 13.8 billion years ago, there emerged matter energy in space-time. Matter energy in space-time. And this matter energy in space-time begins to develop, to differentiate, to move forward. So this realm we would call then the cosmic realm, or in the Eastern tradition, this is frequently referred to as the psychic realm. So we have psychic, subtle, causal, and there's non-dual, but non-dual is the dimensionless point at the center. Dimensionless, we cannot see it. So this realm is that which contains all of nature and the history of our cosmos as we know it. So now I'm going to tell you three little stories, quick time. So what happens then in this universe, part one, in part one of the universe story? Well, matter comes into being, and it begins to gather and form itself into very, very large groups that we call galaxies. And there are hundreds of billions of galaxies in the universe. And the matter that was in those galaxies begins to condense into stars. Stars are collections of hydrogen gas that come together under the laws of gravity. And within gravity, they begin to develop new atoms so that we have hydrogen fusion, and then we have helium, and then we have lithium. All of a sudden, we're beginning, the stars are generating more and more atoms. And the stars live for about 5 million years until they burn themselves out, and then they burst and throw all their stuff out into the galaxy, and then the galaxy forms new stars out of the waste material of the old stars, and we get second generation stars, except their starting material includes more stuff.
Yes.
Arsenal.
You think garden should go gone wrong?
Certainly, you've heard all this before.
Yes, Carol, I have.
So, second and third generation stars, their starting material is more complex because there are bigger atoms sitting out there. So in the case of our sun, which is at least a second, could be third generation star, as it forms, it collects things which are heavier, it gets to bring other things into being, and so we have a planetary system that forms at the same time as our sun begins to form as a star. So our planetary system and our sun are about 5 million years old. Something in that order, 4.8 million years old. Now, of the galaxies, there are hundreds of billions of galaxies, and each galaxy contains hundreds of billions of stars, some of which have planetary systems. So it's pretty big and it's pretty old. So just this far into the history of our universe, this part of the story all by itself tells us, as we look at it, that the universe is self-organizing. That it is nothing that makes it appear as if the divine source had an engineer's plan book about how it was supposed to be put together. But the universe itself, depending on what state it was in, brings forth properties that hold the universe and the cosmos together in its form here as atoms and molecules, and then as stars in galaxies and stars that have planets. And this cosmos over a period of the last 13.8 billion years has been forming its own rules of engagement. And its rules of engagement at this level give us the laws of physics and chemistry, the laws of physical matter, and how physical matter behaves. So the universe tells us that it's not only self-organizing, but it creates and develops an enormous amount of stability with a little bit of dash of chaos. And the little, it isn't spice.
Oh, it's the opposite.
The chaos is where the newness comes in. You see, if it were only stability, then it would be pretty unchanging. But a little chaos that comes in allows for something new to arise. But that one I've never got in your mind and said, I wonder if that applies in my life. The universe itself, there's a constant exchanging or changing of form from matter to energy. Matter turns into energy, and energy condenses into matter. Looking, depending on how we look at it, we see something as solid and material, or we see it as energy. So energy and matter are not different things. They're different forms of the same reality. To make it more clear, this is when I gave up. This is the point that I really gave up. That the matter itself goes back into the potential. Disappears as matter altogether and goes back into potential. And new matter is continually coming into being out of that quantum vacuum. New matter. The universe, our physical universe, is not a closed system. It is an open, evolving, becoming system in every moment of its existence. So, part two. So part two, skipping ahead, so on our planet, which is 4.85 billion years old, about a million years into its development, something really extraordinary happened. And it was when molecules, fairly big molecules, fairly complex molecules, they've been evolving right along as the Earth was forming. In the then warm, salty water of pools and seas, and some of the large molecules, some big molecules, micromolecules, that were joined with one another in a strand that coiled around itself, those molecules unzipped into two separate pieces And each of the strands rebuilt its other half. And all of a sudden, there was something called life, biological life on the planet Earth that arose out of, it was not an accident of, it arose out of the properties and the qualities of the matter itself. And those first forms of life are bacteria. And these are little bacteria that, and all they had was just simply their DNA and a membrane around them that kept them whole. And these bacteria, their ancestors, still live in our guts and digest our food for us. They have to live in the dark out of oxygen. And they are, so we contain about a trillion of these in our bodies, and they help us to digest our food today. So the first part of that is these little simple cells, these single molecules becoming a living matter. And then about a couple of billion years into that, we put it 2 billion years ago, that these bacteria were running into great difficulties, and they needed to create or to evolve more complex forms in order to stay in business. And making a long story very short, they form into a complex cell, which is a large cell that contains a nucleus, contains the DNA. It's a very big cell, it's a large cell. And then these cells, just as they do at the moment that we're conceived, these would be generic stem cells, multiply. And they begin to create and to develop colonies of cells. So we have divide, now we have colony of cells, and all the same, all identical. Until the colony gets large enough that the cells on the inside say, hey, I'm starving down here. The ones on the outside are saying, well, I'm hurting out here. But that conversation doesn't really go on. You got it.
Yeah.
So these colonies of cells now begin to develop cells which choose their jobs. Let's see, we'll have some cells that have been on the outside, and they're going to come in and form a nervous system. We have some cells that are going to make a heart, and that heart is going to pump something that is called blood and connect with the rest of the body. We're going to make bone cells. We're going to have some serve as hair, some serve as toenails, some serve as gut. And in this making specific of the role of the cells, we form organs, and these are distribution of labor kind of a system. And these organs form together. You know, we've got one, we have brain, we have eyes, nose, ears, throat, heart, gut, all those organs on our body. They all work together in one single, unified organism that gives us a body with these incredible qualities. Is this extraordinary?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, this is extraordinary. The complexity of the body is just simply extraordinary. So, part three. So at this point, it's like a family. So the consciousness, which is being breathed, manifested from its core source, and is now exploding into matter energy in space-time. This is consciousness, which is taking the form of matter energy in space-time, becomes complex enough that it begins to awaken. It begins to awaken into a self-reflective consciousness. So we see the formation then, of animals, the formation of a reptilian brain, the capacity for autonomic nervous system and instincts and bodily functions, the formation of a limbic brain. This is in mammals, now you've got to get all the way to mammals to get there. And the limbic brain is able to experience emotion. And what's an emotion? I think that you're going to say that it's an experience in my body that has meaning. I've got this experience in my body and it means rage. I have this experience in my body and it means sorrow. I have this experience in my body, and it means compassion. So this whole level of emotion develops in the mammal. The brain develops a third portion of neocortex, the right and the left half of the neocortex, which gives way to thinking and language and awareness and self-consciousness. Notice that all of this form is still made up of those little atoms and molecules that started at the beginning of the cosmos. So at this point, what are the qualities of the cosmos given this perspective? Is that the cosmos itself is self-organizing, and that it is moving towards life, and moving towards consciousness, and moving towards freedom. It tells us that it is intelligent, that the cosmos itself is intelligent. It tells us that it's all about relationship, all the way down to the beginning of matter, to the relationships between animals and relationship between persons. It tells us that it is not finished, it is still in the process of becoming. And it tells us that it reflects, it embodies, it manifests the qualities of its divine source. It manifests goodness, truth, beauty, love, and life. So the individual human, we're concerned. So as an individual person, I begin with one single complex cell. And now, this one complex cell is going to gestate in the womb of the mother for 9 months. And this one cell is going to contain within itself already the rules of matter, because you're made up of atoms and molecules. And it also is going to embody and recapitulate all of the steps and stages in the evolution of life for the 2 billion year period between that first complex cell and the human beings. So you do in 9 months what it took 2 billion years to do the first time. Because there's an instruction manual. And the instruction manual is the genes. The instruction manual gives the instructions for, you've seen these on TV time and time again, where people have implanted cameras during gestation and actually film the process of a baby developing over this gestational period. And you see this little baby go through all of these stages. That's you. Yes, sometimes even there's a memory. So now we're born. So when we're born, our consciousness is pretty much still a unit of consciousness, because I have to add a little experience. And so our consciousness now differentiates. And in differentiating, it's differentiating in order to allow the human being to fulfill her, his potential for self-reflective consciousness, to awaken to that which is, and to be able to interact with it, to relate with it, to respond to it, to be aware of it in a conscious way. And the instruction manual for how to do that, the instruction manual the instruction manual for behaving like a human being, the genes are just about none, is the culture. Our culture is what teaches us. You see, the development of human language probably took about 10, 20, 30,000 years for our forefathers. And we've got it down pretty well by the time you're 3 years old. You know, and they keep sending us to school earlier and earlier. And everything that the human family has learned goes in libraries, goes in computers now, but you see, it gets continued and it gets passed on in an easier fashion than the whole history that brought it together. So the culture serves as our instruction manual to form us. Notice that the culture is not nearly as unforgiving and rigid as the laws of physics, nor even of the laws of life in DNA. So we change culture much more easily and faster than those other methods, but we still have that stability and limitation a drug to conform to our culture. That came up a lot of times since last year. That came up a lot of times. So we adapt to our culture in order to survive. If we do not adapt to our culture, they won't feed us, they won't clothe us, and they won't let us play their games. So we gotta play the, we gotta adapt to the culture in order to get through the first few months of our, first few years of our lives. So the beginning of the individual, this is my image, and my image came up because I was asking the question, what does this core self look like? And this is the image that came to me of this core self. This core self, our essence, our own individual human essence, our soul, our personal dynamic ground, our deep psyche, use any of those words, I see as our point of origin or the source of the individual human being. And this core essence, this embodied soul is connected to and embodies presence and capabilities. It's connected all the way down through and in. I'll give you a diagram to illustrate that in just a moment. And this core self, which is conceived and goes into a human, contains all of the potential for you. It contains all of the potentialities that are within your embodiment as a human that has the probabilities and possibilities of your human form that you can bring forward during the course of your lifetime. Okay, well, go. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Yes. Show me that again. Okay.
So the universe.
So the universe tells us that we exist in relationship to the whole, that we're a result of, that we're connected to and representative of the whole, that we're not done. And although we are totally insignificant in terms of time or in terms of space, that we have the capacity to remember and to respond all the way down to our divine source. Rumi, 13th century, he's 14th century. No, he's 13th because he's contemporary with Francis of Assisi. He doesn't know anything about evolution. So this is pure revelation to Rumi. We began as an animal. We emerged into plant life and into an animal state and then to being human. And always we have forgotten our former states, except in early spring. When we dimly recall being green again. So that is how a young person turns toward a teacher. A baby leans towards the breast without knowing the secret of its desire and yet turning instinctively. So humankind is led along an evolving course through this migration of intelligences, and though we seem to be sleeping, there's an inner wakefulness that directs the dream. It will eventually startle us back to the truth of who we are. I'm going to skip this. It's a great one. This final image then is I'm showing that us, individual human person, are within the realm of human consciousness, within the realm of collective unconsciousness, within our whole cosmic nature realm, embedded within the realm of the spiritual qualities, embedded within the realm of the divine. And I've drawn it off center because we're all in direct touch. I am afraid, we lost the control here. That's one good way to. I'm going to do this very quick. I don't want to leave it out. So, as human persons, we can come to a recognition. Well, let me say one other thing. The traditions have recognized that faith and love and hope lead to the transformation of our human consciousness. I ask the question, how or why can love and hope and faith lead to transformation of consciousness? And by transformation of consciousness, I personally mean the restructuring of our personalities in such a way to deepen our own wholeness and integration. So I would just give you for your reflection that love is really the ground of all things. Love is absolutely the ground. It's a transcendent. It's not the fundamental. It's the core essence of all things. We recognize it as Plato, the good, the true, the beautiful. And most recently, I recognized that life itself, if you start tracing it back and back and back, is also a transcendental, and life is one of the core qualities itself. Faith. Faith is the certainty of knowing that I participate in love. It's the certainty that I participate. It's the realization that I am in participating in the work of love within the universe. It is the recognition that I am a part of the whole. Therefore, hope, and hope's come up a couple of times already in our time together. Hope is not about the future, it's about the present. So since all is love and I participate in it, since the cosmos, including humankind, unfolds in a harmonious and lawful manner, I trust that the world is unfolding in an optimizing manner. I enter into freedom by my consent to enter into the flow of the unfolding, and I respond to love as the origin and the center of my own being. That's a really big cosmic view, but it's in the, I'm going to make a suggestion on that, Joe. So in the context of our meeting here, one of the things that you're going to take away what you're going to take away, which might be nothing. But it seems to me that maybe, no, from this talk, you say, hey, look, leave the science out next time, okay?
Bring Carol, but leave the science.
But one of the things that might strike us is that the cosmos itself is sustained and enlivened by its divine source while remaining free, while the cosmos remains free to organize itself. That the role of God is not to make it rain or not rain today. God is not arranging the stars, either for our convenience or against our convenience. That He is making the cosmos in such a way that it is organizing itself. But our source continues to leave us free and sustain and enliven the cosmos with its qualities. It says that our source doesn't cause or engineer the particular details of our lives, but is present in all things, in sustaining life and invoking love. It says that our presence, our experience, our suffering, and our love are real and enough. So Marianne, I didn't put these, but I see people trying to get photos. Would you send, just take the slides and email them to people? They'll be big enough for them to see. Thank you for
being here.